Good morning, everyone. My name is Jennifer Cook. I'm director of the Africa program here at CSIS, and I'd like to welcome you to CSIS and today's event on Africa's regional economic outlook. This is part of a series called the Chevron Forum on Development. Chevron has partnered with CSIS through our U.S. Leadership in Development project, which is co-led by Johanna Nesseth and Dan Rundy, to look at ways to more fully incorporate and harness the strength of the private sector and the business community in U.S. development assistance and planning and activities. The Africa program has been looking at this through the Africa policy lens. Africa's relatively robust economic growth performance over the last decade has really begun to shift the narrative on Africa, and this Africa rising scenario has generated a lot of interest among global investors and policymakers. There's some debate about how real or sustainable this rise will be. Our take is that, and we'll hear it from today's speakers, their thoughts, is that this rise is real. And that the opportunities for growth are going to be enduring. But the bigger question is whether African governments seize and manage this opportunity for maximal benefit. This means getting at some of the long-standing impediments to accelerated growth, infrastructure, we all know them well, infrastructure, power generation, human capacity, regional integration. And all of these really require strategic vision, planning, and often very difficult trade-offs by African governments, and we're going to hear about some of those today. So in the Africa program, we've been looking at how African governments and private investors have been tackling these challenges, and how the U.S. can best coordinate its efforts to assist. The U.S. is moving in this direction, elevating the trade and investment and the economic engagement agenda was a major new element in President Obama's strategy for sub-Saharan Africa, announced last year. And President Obama's trip to Africa at the end of June and early July will certainly feature this agenda as a big priority. So this panel, I think, in the run-up to that trip makes is a very timely and valuable look at the outlook for Africa, and I'm very happy to welcome our speakers today. We're really delighted to host Dr. Antoinette Sayeh, who has been director of the Africa Department of the International Monetary Fund since 2008. I think most of you know her. She was former finance minister of Liberia at a particularly difficult and critical time in that country's immediate post-war history. She's had a long career at the World Bank, working in several African countries, in Afghanistan and Pakistan. Dr. Sayeh today is going to talk about the IMF's most recent regional outlook report for Africa. It comes out annually. The most recent was just released this month. And we'll talk about the continent's growth prospects, but also some of the risks and some of the critical steps that African governments are going to need to take to mitigate those risks. Next, we have Stephen Cashin. You have their bios, so I won't go in at a great length, but Steve Cashin is founder and CEO of Pan-African Capital Group. As you'll see, he has long been focused on investment, trade, and African markets. Before it was trendy, dating back to his time at Peace Corps in Zanzibar some time ago, I won't say how long, and former associate of CSIS, and I think he'll recall some of the recommendations he made over a decade ago that are now just coming into vogue. So finally, we have Sean Nolan, who's deputy director of the Africa Department at the IMF. And Dr. Nolan is going to delve into some of the chapters of the report that focus in particular on creating fiscal space in African countries to mitigate potential future shocks, and to the very timely issue of undoing energy subsidies and how that can be done in a sensitive political way that kind of undoes some of the distortions around energy consumption and energy investment. And we'll leave ample time for question and answers, but we'll begin with Dr. Sayeh, and welcome. So glad you're able to do this.
Well, thank you so much, Jennifer. Thank you for that very generous introduction, and thanks for inviting us here today. It's really a pleasure for us to do this and to join you in a discussion of sub-Saharan Africa. Lots of interest, of course, these days in the region, and we're enthused by that and want to do our part to put out the analytic work and the economic work that the IMF spends a lot of time doing on sub-Saharan Africa. And we produce, actually, still I'm happy to say, Jennifer, twice a year, a regional economic outlook on sub-Saharan Africa, 45 countries covered by our department. And we put that report out, of course, on the same schedule as the World Economic Outlook that the fund produces, and the last version of that being published in April. We are fond of acronyms in the IMF, so we call this Regional Economic Outlook the RIO. And the RIO includes two components. The first looks at recent economic developments, is an analytic review of recent developments in the region, the near-term outlook for the region. And the second part of the RIO normally delves in more detail into selected topics of immediate relevance for policymakers. And Jennifer already referred to one of those, which is energy subsidy reform that we cover in this report. So I'll cover the review and the near-term outlook in my presentation, and then Sean will discuss specific topics explored in this report. So let me start and start even further. So I'll look at four pieces. First, what we can refer to as sub-Saharan Africa's long-delayed growth spurt, just to provide the context of this long period of growth we've seen in the region. And then I'll move on to talk about recent economic developments in the near-term outlook, that is in 2013-2014. And then move on to discuss the key risk to that outlook and how the region might be effective if those risks materialize. And finally, I'll conclude by summarizing the macroeconomic policy choices we think decision makers in the region face. So let me start with this slide and a brief comment on where sub-Saharan Africa has come from and stands in terms of overall growth and poverty indicators. For the first time since the late 1970s, a large number of countries in the region have really enjoyed an extended period of rapid, solid economic growth, beginning in the mid-1990s. That growth period only interrupted by the Great Recession of 2009. But overall, growth in the sub-region has averaged about 5% since 1995. That's a significant turnaround from where sub-Saharan Africa was in the previous two decades before that, where we, you know, characterized by falling living standards in many countries. And in terms of poverty and what has happened there, poverty levels have come down significantly, just under 50% now, about 48%. Of course, not stellar compared to the progress that has been achieved in other developing countries, but certainly important achievements in the past decade and a half. Many factors contributed to the turnaround in economic fortunes in the region. Domestic factors, of course, and then external factors as well. Just flagging some of the key domestic factors in three areas. Certainly, much sounder macroeconomic policies, including strengthening of fiscal positions across many countries, containment of inflation is now in single digits in most countries, liberalizing elaborate foreign exchange controls, unification of exchange rates, all of that in the macro policy area, but one area. The second area, trade and regulatory reforms, quite a bit of that. Contentious and controversial, structural reforms and all of the stereotypes that people have of that. But covering scaling back of direct state intervention in the economies, more space for the private sector, Of course, having said that, there's still a lot of work to do in that regard in terms of improving the investment climate for the private sector. The third very important area and contributor to this turnaround was the reduction in armed conflict and civil turmoil in many countries in the region. Think way back 20 years ago and where countries like Mozambique, Angola, Sierra Leone, Rwanda have come from, and all of those countries, of course, having gone through their own civil wars and recovered from it. And a second aspect of this reduced turmoil, of course, increased political stability and transition of power in a number of countries, the most obvious one being Ghana, that has had a series of elections now and made transitions very smoothly. External factors that helped with this turnaround, first, broadly favorable commodity prices across several commodities and, discovery of oil and other natural resources in a number of countries, Uganda, Burkina, Rwanda, Ethiopia. Those are countries that I just flagged that are not natural resource producers that did very well in any case. So it's important to understand that natural resources an important factor in growth in some countries, but that the growth story in sub-Saharan Africa is much larger than natural resources. Many countries who didn't have natural resources have done quite well. And on the international side, international debt relief initiatives were very important to enable sub-Saharan Africa to make the fiscal space to invest in areas critical for development. So those are some of the factors explaining what has happened. Now let me move on to first talk about the global context very briefly, drawing on the April 2013 World Economic Outlook. And of course, this outlook is subject to significant uncertainty. Though when we compare it to where to the uncertainties we talked about last fall, those risks have come down somewhat. And at last fall, we were all very focused here in the U.S. on the fiscal cliff, and that is now seemingly behind us. But this global growth is now often described as one of a multi-speed economy in the global economy these days, with emerging markets and developing countries growing very strongly. The U.S. Economy gradually gaining some momentum, notwithstanding the significant fiscal adjustment underway. And much of Europe experiencing little or no growth, with the Eurozone now expected to actually contract slightly in 2013. And against this backdrop of sluggish global growth, world commodity prices are expected to ease somewhat during 2013-14, but relative to the period before the crisis, to still be generally favorable for exporters. So now coming to the continent, we find that it's helpful when talking about developments in sub-Saharan Africa to split the region into four country groupings. The first grouping being the oil exporters in yellow in this map, and those oil exporters are countries that export more than 30%. Their exports are 30% or more in oil. Middle-income countries with per capita incomes above $993 or so. Low-income countries with per capita incomes below that. And the so-called fragile states in red in this map, and they're classified as fragile based on political division and instability or because they have exceptionally weak institutions. But even with that breakdown, we find it sometimes is important and useful to further subdivide those groupings. For example, they're now they're long-established middle-income countries like South Africa, but they're very newcomers to the MIC groups, like Ghana, for example. So still more disaggregation of those groupings. And the groupings have changed over time, reflecting the evolution of economies in the region. And as the map shows, we have a most recent change in 2011 when Ghana, Senegal, Zambia, we're all moved from the low-income country category to now middle-income country groups. And some fragile states actually also moved. Sierra Leone, for example, used to be a fragile state, is now considered a normal low-income country. So the broad trend we see in these country groupings is that fragile and low-income groups should gradually shrink, we think, with some countries graduating to middle-income group and possibly others becoming oil exporters. It's, of course, not a linear process, and we've seen countries move backwards. Cote d'Ivoire, that used to be just about a middle-income country, moved backwards to the group of fragile countries a few years ago when it had the problems we all know it had. So those are the country groupings we have when we talk about developments in sub-Saharan Africa. How does the region then look? What is the outlook we see against the backdrop of the global economy? We expect output growth in sub-Saharan Africa will accelerate this year to about 5.4% from 5.1% last year, and accelerate even further to 5.7% in 2014. And some people tell us we're far too optimistic about sub-Saharan Africa, but I hope that the context I set in showing you how long the region has grown and the resilience that the region demonstrated relative to the 2009 global recession speaks to the fact that this growth we think is sustainable, and we see it continuing. What are the factors we see supporting these projections? Maybe three broad factors. First, that international commodity prices will in the main remain relatively high. They'll come down slightly in 2013 and 14, but overall are quite high and good for exporters. Second factor is that domestic demand in sub-Saharan African countries will continue to provide, we think, solid support to growth, domestic demand coming from both public and private investments. And the latter, private investments, often linked to natural resource production in a number of countries. And the third broad area is that a number of supply factors explain better growth in some countries. First, the agricultural output is recovering in many countries after the droughts that we saw in West and East Africa. And there's increased oil production in a number of oil producers, Angola, Chad, and Nigeria. And a number of new natural resource projects coming on stream in countries like Niger and Niger and petroleum and iron ore in Sierra Leone. And of course, fortunately, a strong post-conflict recovery in Cote d'Ivoire explains very high growth rates there. But of course, not all countries will show this very robust growth. In particular, middle-income countries are continuing to face problems. The picture is very mixed there. Most countries in that group, but most notably South Africa, have been hard hit by the global crisis. And that reflects in part their closer links, of course, to Europe. Europe is South Africa's largest export market. And like most analysts, we see the South African economy that slowed in 2012, we see it still not just reviving only gradually this year, with growth still below 3% in South Africa. And with regard to inflation, as you see in the right side panel on the screen, inflation receded in 2012 in most countries in the region, and we expect that trend to continue in 2013-2014. And explaining that, it has been a moderation of food price inflation. Also, local weather conditions have improved in many parts of Africa that previously suffered from a drought. And that has benefited food markets in a number of countries. Of course, in a number of other countries, and in particular in conflict-affected countries, food security has remained a significant problem. And an additional factor explaining the slowdown in inflation, of course, has been the implementation of very tight monetary policies in a number of countries that had seen huge surges in inflation in 2011. Those countries mostly in East Africa, so Kenya, Uganda, and to a lesser extent, Tanzania. I will turn quickly now to public finance and talk about the picture in regard to fiscal balances, which is a mixed one, with surplus positions in several oil exporters, Angola, Chad, Republic of Congo. Those surplus positions now weakening as a result of sharp increases in public spending. Fiscal deficits have risen in many middle-income countries, but for different reasons in those countries. In Ghana, of course, Ghana's budget deficit in 2012 expanded significantly, reaching about 12% or so, in response to pressures around, in an election year for Ghana. And by contrast, a country like South Africa, deficits rising there also, but reflecting the impact of the sluggish domestic economy and policy adjustments that were taken to try to support weak demand in South Africa. And a mixed picture also looking at government debt in the region, and you see that in the right side of the panel with low-income countries. The debt had fallen quite sharply, of course, in response to debt relief, and have risen really only marginally since then. In the middle-income countries, by contrast, and South Africa there again carries a very large weight, public debt levels rising with the onset of the global crisis, reflecting the deficits that countries had trying to respond to that. Our projections are that debt levels should stabilize in these middle-income countries in the near term. And moving quickly to the external positions in the region, what you see there is just to stress that current account deficits, as you see in the left side of the panel, are steadily increasing in both low-income and middle-income countries, and reflecting, of course, in some countries, sluggish performance of exports, such as in South Africa again, but also high import demand associated with investments in many other countries, many of the low-income countries in particular. And again, a mixed picture, a different picture for oil exporters. They typically had improved positions in 2012, but large fiscal expansions in some of these countries into investments, infrastructure investments in particular, are contributing or projected to contribute to a decline in the external surpluses in 2013 and 14. And low-income countries, their deficits have been financed largely by foreign direct investment into some of those natural resource projects I talked about, but also from loans, both concessional and non-concessional loans, and and some of that, those loans have been linked to mineral resources as well. In middle-income countries, and here Ghana and South Africa, and some oil exporters like Nigeria, in those countries, in addition to the foreign direct investments we've seen flowing into those countries, there have been now sizable inflows into domestic bond and or stock markets. We've been seeing that in response to global investors' search for yield in African frontier markets. And Sean will maybe talk a little bit about that also when we talk about the issue of also of sovereign bonds. So looking at the right side of the panel that looks at reserves in sub-Saharan Africa, reserve coverage, and this is measured in terms of the number of months of imports coverage that they can provide. Over the past 2 years, relatively modest changes in reserve coverage, and in middle-income countries, reserves remain around the same level recorded prior to the global crisis, about 4 months of imports. And foreign reserve levels in low-income countries have typically risen in dollar terms from year to year, but reserve coverage of imports has drifted downwards in recent years. And most of the countries in the region, however, have foreign reserve coverage about at least 3 months of imports, which is traditionally seen as the minimum prudent level for countries. But of course, optimal reserve coverage is different and it's higher, typically in countries exposed to more volatile capital flows or highly dependent on one or two export commodities. And that's the case with the oil exporters in the region in particular. I'm moving right along. To sum up, just to say, of course, that the near-term outlook for the region as a whole remains favorable, as with moderate acceleration of growth in 2013-2014 and gradual easing of inflation. And this outlook is, of course, subject to risk and is contingent on the global economy continuing to recover and, of course, the implementation of sound macroeconomic policies in sub-Saharan Africa itself. And turning quickly now to the risk, a number of risks discussed in the World Economic Outlook covering risks such as the prolonged near stagnation in the Eurozone, significant slowdown in major emerging market economies, adverse shocks to world oil prices that may come from geopolitical developments, and possibly significant shift in market sentiments in both the US and in Japan. In the event that the medium-term fiscal challenges are not perceived to be addressed credibly. And finally, adverse side effects from unconventional monetary policies, such as quantitative easing. Our country teams have looked at the impact of these risks on sub-Saharan Africa, and the broad conclusion is that growth could be slowed somewhat, but not severely. And a number of countries, of course, would be more severely affected, those that depend on a single commodity, for example. But by and large, growth would remain strong in the region. Domestic risks to sub-Saharan Africa include, of course, the threat to agriculture production from adverse climate shocks, and climate change is already having a considerable impact in some African countries. And also, of course, the intensification of internal conflicts in some countries. We followed developments in Mali, in the Central African Republic, in Guinea-Bissau, eastern part of Democratic Republic of Congo. If those situations deteriorate, of course, the impact could spill over into some neighboring countries. So having looked at the outlook, just to touch briefly now on some of the main challenges that policymakers face. I think maybe four issues to flag. First, that upper middle income countries will continue to see sluggish growth, and in a context where their policy space for providing stimulus is quite limited. And second, inflation will remain in double digits in a handful of countries, and monetary policy should remain cautious in those countries. And a third challenge is that large current account deficits in several low-income countries require careful analysis and monitoring. And finally, that international reserves are quite low in some countries, in a few cases, for example, in Ethiopia. And so they could do with some boosting, including another country, for example, Ghana could also do more on the reserve side. So another point is that fiscal imbalances are emerging in several countries, and so those also need to be washed and dealt with. And capital inflows and debt accumulation are emerging as issues in many countries in the region. Frontier economies like Ghana and Nigeria need to be careful in balancing the benefits and risk associated with attracting large volumes of portfolio inflows into government bond and equity markets. And so those are quite significant challenges for policymakers in the region, macroeconomic challenges, that is. Finally, with the risk of global slowdown still persisting, policymakers need to assess to what extent they have fiscal space, policy room, not just fiscal, but monetary also, to manage an adverse shock. And many countries in the region have very little room to finance larger deficits if there's a slowdown, because they have thin domestic financial markets. Even if they have low debt burdens, they just don't have the domestic financial markets to expand their borrowing. And with that constraint, we think that countries that are growing fast currently and have these thin policy buffers should really give priority to strengthening their fiscal positions and their foreign reserve levels. And countries with fiscal policy space may be able to have their deficits increase when they're hit by a downturn. Countries with monetary autonomy and strong track records of containing inflation, and that's the case with South Africa, for example, could ease monetary policy in response to a downturn. And countries with market-determined exchange rates, like in Kenya, of course, can allow their exchange rates to depreciate and to act as a shock absorber to downturn. So let me stop there. I think I've gone on a little longer than anticipated. And thank you very much for your attention. Look forward to the discussion.
Thanks very much, Dr. Sayeh. That gives us a great frame for subsequent discussions and questions and answers. We're going to turn to Steve Cashin. View from the outside.
View from the other side. No, the thank you very much. Good morning, Dr. Sayeh. That was a terrific and very different analysis of the African markets than we would have seen even just a few years ago. While Dr. Sayeh is diplomatic and cautious with her words, to me that was a resounding cheerleading effect for the African markets, with a caution to say manage it, because we have an opportunity for growth and an environment for growth in a manner that I don't think we've seen in the past. And just as a quick aside, the reference to the medium term issues in the Japan and the United States, I don't know if you were reading the Financial Times this morning, but that poor Japanese woman pulling out her hair, I didn't know whether medium was more what framework medium was, but listen. The financial environments in Africa have been characterized by silos and lack of transparency for my lifetime. There have been huge efforts which can in no way be belittled derided by the fund, the development institutions, the development finance institutions, and the whole development finance network that have resulted in a debt reduction and a creation of a platform and core environment that has opened up the markets in Africa in a way that the leaders of the financial markets in Africa have an opportunity to scale up in a way that we've never seen before. The report, the IMF report, demonstrates a real beginning of real seeds of change. And to me, that's very, very exciting. It also points out a number of areas where my world and Antoinette's world are working together in a way that just didn't exist before. And I think that is as healthy a beginning as we've seen for a long, long time. As Jennifer mentioned earlier, I actually will have a few points of show and tell from the past in my comments, in as much as in 1998, when I was in a bit of a transition from the banking world to the private equity world, CSIS gave me a home. And in sitting here, as I debated, and CSIS developed a financial working group on Africa, which no one else at the time had. And in sitting here, working with Dr. Connie Freeman, I said there's no transition for African governments moving from structural adjustment to a market-driven economy. And she looked at me and said, oh, come on, there are a lot of different opportunities. And I said, well, in my world, we look at credit ratings in terms of evaluating risk. It just is what it is. It's not right, wrong, indifferent, it is. And within the development finance community, we look at different indicators. And there was no product to bridge that divide. And we had some discussions with the IMF. No one on this panel was included in those discussions. But they were actually very close working relationships with us at the time. And we said we would like to introduce, we would like to do a meeting and a workshop on the impact that sovereign credit ratings could have in the African markets. And the IMF looked at us and said, you've got to be off your rocker. But we did it. And this is the report from 1998. It's small, but it would be a whole lot bigger today because it ended up following with support from the US government in terms of Fitch funding the ratings of the first seven countries in Africa, followed by UNDP, followed more importantly by African governments taking it on their own and working in cooperation with the development and the development finance community to ensure that data is public. And data comes from a number of different sources for people to be able to evaluate in the manners in which they feel most appropriate. A year ago, Dr. Sayeh and I spoke at a conference sponsored by Ernst & Young. And it was a totally different type of conference than I've ever been at. They had a map on the floor. And there were a few irreverent things on the map. But the point was they approached their evaluation of data in a different way than either the IMF or I or many others would do. And it was healthy because it looked at it slightly differently and it became it's a stronger balance for all of us to evaluate and make determinations on the risk parameters that exist in the African markets for us to make decisions as it relates to the appropriateness of investment in those markets. There is an evolving balance between political leadership and economic and financial leadership, good governance and the judiciary, the weakest still being the judiciary across the continent. If you get in trouble, you get in real trouble. That's in spite of all of the efforts being made on improved governance in many different respects, the judiciary does remain weak and does require a real focus. The continent is emerging from a generation of also no commercial leadership. There's been political leadership, there's been economic leadership, there have been a lot of different types of leadership, and it's now time for its commercial leaders to show their capability, their determination, and their determination for good governance across the continent. Support for the commercial environment and leadership has been kind of muddled for a long time. The, as Dr. Sayeh mentioned earlier, there's been a strong focus on macro fundamentals, government implementation, but when it comes to building the commercial environment, and specifically the environment that I work in, the financial environment, the development community focused on a lot of different things. Private equity over here, microfinance over here, and now there's a lot of talk about impact investing and SME investing. Well, what is SME if it's not just the market? Why are we creating a new term for Africa? To me, it goes back to the issue of what are we doing with the commercial banks in Africa? And the commercial banks, and the answer is not enough and not a lot. And the regional commercial banks in Africa need, there's a balance between the international governance environments that they need to follow and their ability to implement on the ground, and the two do not meet. Nor is there a focus on the regionalization of treasuries, of treasury markets, risk credit markets, and other governance factors that will improve the commercial banking industry across the continent and will be the basis for the responsible scaling up of the financial industry across the continent. Africa has a lot of the capital to begin to evolve that environment. The pension funds in Africa are scaling up considerably. The insurance markets are scaling up considerably. And they can play a real role in improving, as core investors, the commercial banking markets, the bond markets, which historically have been driven by offshore as opposed to onshore, and the equity issues, which again have been characterized by offshore money. And in my mind, you're never going to have the governance you need until it's your own dough. And I know because I invest my own dough. And and there are very few of us who do. There are very few who have their own money in Africa. And it requires, in my mind, your own money to really force the governance side of the improved governance across the continent. A couple of sort of little anecdotes. One of the companies in which we've invested in years ago, DataBank, launched the first mutual fund that invested in all the stock markets in Africa, the EPAC fund. The returns have been absolutely exponential. We had 40% annualized returns for over a decade. The last few years have been significantly reduced given the overall equity markets across Africa and across the world. But based on a 15-year track record, we are now launching a fund which is an offshore fund, building on the experience of 15 years of operations. There are a lot of other examples like that that can be implemented across the continent, using the experience on the ground to leverage and bring in additional capital. In the report, there was a reference to ensuring that in looking at the international bond markets, countries need to be careful to ensure that they don't move back into unhealthy borrowing approaches. There are a number of examples of unhealthy borrowing in the bond markets. Some of those examples relate to countries that the international community is celebrating and not looking at the local environment. I think we need to be careful, and I think that that goes back to the whole issue of those bonds need to be driven from the local market and scaled into the international market. So you incorporate the local risk parameters as you are developing the overall risk profile of the product that you're launching. You're seeing an Africa presenting a huge opportunities for change over the next decade. If you look at Ethiopia and Nigeria, which very few people seem to equate, but there are lots of similarities in terms of scale and opportunity. Ethiopia has the cheapest power in Africa. Nigeria has the most, maybe not the most expensive. I think that we win that in Liberia, but in a scale, it has significantly higher power. Ethiopia remains a very closed and controlled market. Nigeria is a chaotic, vibrant market. As Ethiopia opens up, what impact does that have to the rest of the continent? As Nigeria puts a little bit more structure around its growth, what impact does that have? I think it can be significant, and I think we need to start looking at the regionalization of growth. As Dr. Sayeh mentioned, there are a number of areas of real growth on the continent, real opportunities for growth. Agriculture is huge. Commodities and oil, absolutely, and it needs to be recognized. And I don't buy into the threats that people present to us in terms of the negative impact of commodities. There can be very strong impacts from growth in the commodities and oil sector if you've got responsible governance. And I think it is beholden to the people of Africa to ensure that their leaders do lead them in a responsible manner. And I think you're beginning to see that in country after country after country. I also think that a lot of the issues around commodities and agriculture have to do with concession agreements. And I think that goes back to the judiciary and back to governance, and it is possible to do responsible concession agreements that impact our children or their children in the way that they should. I think governments need to continue to focus on some of the stumbling blocks. Land tenure, it's time. Incentives, Dr. Sayeh and I don't always agree on what incentives should be, but I think that governments can do more to attract other investors in a number of different ways. I mentioned earlier, the more information and the more transparency that exists across the continent, the more investors you're going to have, and the reduced with each additional dollar, the risk that one exposes oneself across the continent reduces. There are a number of initiatives being launched by the U.S. government today. Power Africa, Feed the Future, there are others. I think we need to take a real look at what those initiatives are. I think every initiative will only improve the relationship, and I think that we need to look at how our initiatives can impact not only the improved political governance across Africa, but the improved economic returns on a more regionalized basis. As it relates to that, I think the ADB can play a huge role. I think the ADB is led by a man who I refer to as the senior prefect, who has the credibility to introduce products that do have a double bottom line, both in terms of scaling up infrastructure on a regional basis and requiring some concessions as it relates to governance of the financial institutions across Africa. And I think it's worth beginning to explore how they may take a more leading role in that effort. And with those comments, I'm going to end by saying I think we're at a very different stage. I think we're at a stage where there is a lot more openness, a lot more cooperation, and a recognition that in order to scale up the commercial and investment climate across continent, we need to be working together. And there are many, many transactions where you need to have a multiple of different types of financial products, with debt, with donor funds right down at, on the bottom, taking the majority of risk, leveraged by development finance, private equity, commercial debt, all within a one financial structure supporting the same transactions in a manner that I think can be healthier and stronger in the long run. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was terrific. Sean, we'll turn to you.
Good morning, everybody. Pleasure to be here. I have a relatively short period of time. What I want to do a short commercial and then tell you three stories. Being Irish, I respond to a time constraint not by saying less, but by speaking a lot faster. So I apologize. I apologize for that in advance. Firstly, the commercial. As Antoinette mentioned, we produce this regional outlook twice a year. We only do it for sub-Saharan Africa on a biannual basis because. It's the one continent where there is, one region where there's relatively little analysis provided by the financial, the investment banks, the European Union, whatever. So we actually find that this is the one, probably the most timely set of consistent data on Africa that's produced every 6 months. And it had an interesting side effect is when you start reading analyst reports on countries you're covering, say Nigeria, Ken, you're firstly amazed at the fact that the analyst tends to agree with just what you think, which empowers you in your belief that you're right. And then you actually realize, oh, actually, they're really basing this on the IMF analysis, and actually, there's no value added, and you may still be as wrong as you thought you might be in the first place. But anyway, we'll try and cover lots of different topics, and what's actually interesting about the topics is they're not academic. They're all produced by the problems that our country teams are encountering, and that so it's, they tend to be bottom-up in terms of what we take a hold of and take a look at. Three stories. The first one is on fiscal policy space, who has it? Sounds a bit obscure. I hope I can address that one quickly. Second one, I'll touch on sovereign bond issue, and then we'll turn to energy subsidy reform. On fiscal policy space, what are we talking about here? Well, one of the most striking features, in fact, one of the most dramatic features to growth in sub-Saharan Africa in the last two decades is summarized in the black line there on the left-hand panel, which is the rate of growth of the low-income countries in Africa. And what's striking about it is, where's Lehman? Where's 2009? Where's the collapse? The answer is, in low-income countries, growth remained, it obviously dipped, but it remained relatively robust. This is a striking break from the past, where global crisis, you know, the global economy caught cold and Africa caught pneumonia, boom, bust cycles, major macroeconomic disruption, etc. So why was it so different this time? You may say, well, the middle-income countries is a big dip. That's largely a South Africa story. So one of the factors that contributed to resilience was the idea, was the fact that governments were in a position, both in middle-income countries and in low-income countries, to allow fiscal deficits expand, i.e. they could finance. They had the room, the fiscal room, to finance larger deficits. Why does this matter? It matters because think of the Greece scenario. If you have no access to financing and you experience an adverse shock, revenues go down, you have no choice but to then further cut expenditures, producing a sort of a constantly pro-cyclical policy that deepens recession. In this case, African governments avoided that trap and were able to finance, able to provide some stimulus, some support to economic, to demand in the economies. What I'm looking at, and what this paper is looking at, and I'm just telling you the story of, is looking across countries right now and saying, okay, who has the room to handle a downturn, or who is going to come knocking on the door of either the donors or the international financial institutions for assistance? And we look at it from three angles. One is to say, okay, which countries are constrained by high debt levels? Then secondly, who has got domestic markets deep enough to allow the government to increase significantly its borrowing in those markets for a temporary period of time during the downturn? And then, of course, which countries have sizable financial assets that they can draw on to finance a downturn, to finance spending during the downturn? I'll try and answer these three questions quickly. Antoinette has already presented part of this chart, which is the story about debt levels across the region. Of course, after a period of strong growth, after a period of substantial debt relief, the general debt burden story is generally quite favorable. Burden debt, as you can see, this chart on the right probably summarizes it best because it conveys a distribution. So much lower debt levels in most cases. What countries do debt levels, are they still a high burden constraining fiscal policy and its possible response to a downturn? There are a few. There are a number of low-income countries that still have either in debt distress or very high levels of debt, such that you can't see anybody lending them any money. Examples would be probably the Gambia, Burundi, DRC, Comoros, Swaziland. These are a number of smaller countries in the main where debt levels are still very high, even in some cases after HIPC, after debt relief, they still remain high. A second group of countries is countries like Ghana and South Africa, where debt levels are not necessarily exceptionally high, but they've risen very sharply over time, and the bond markets are beginning to become troubled. The rating agencies are becoming troubled. So South Africa, for example, in its response to the downturn, global, to the continued weakness of economic activity, to Marikana, et cetera, is actually quite the very, very limited room, because the more they increase the deficits, the faster the accumulation of debt, the more the rating agencies get worried, and the more the cost of funds goes up. So South Africa and Ghana are countries where there are actually significant, some constraints from the high levels, the relatively high levels of debt. And there are a few other special cases. Eritrea, Zimbabwe are examples. They're countries that are either in deep distress or in debt distress or else are characterized by complete financial repression. So that's one angle, the debt angle. The second one is the ability to borrow. And we say domestic borrowing here because in a global downturn, access to external markets, private markets, is going to dry up, certainly for general budget finance. And so we look at in the chapter at how deep are the markets and to what extent is the borrowing capacity, both from borrowing from the banks and also from capital markets, gobbled up by the government, the fiscal dominance problem. And who's got deep markets and where the government is not dominating them? Because in those circumstances, the government can indeed expand its borrowing. And what's the bottom line here? Again, you won't be too surprised. In poorer countries and smaller countries, typically, financial markets are very shallow. The ability of the government to increase its borrowing in a downturn, quite limited. Big crowding out of private sector investment when you do it, sharp increase in interest rates. But there are countries, Kenya, Mauritius, South Africa, Nigeria come to mind, where financial markets, domestic markets are quite deep, where the government's not the biggest borrower on the block, and so they're able to respond in a downturn by increased borrowing and financing larger deficits. There are various cases that I'd describe as a judgment call where you'd really have to get into the details of the country case to see whether or not there is room. Senegal's an example that comes to mind. The last issue where the countries can turn to when in an economic downturn is the question of, does the government have financial assets, either offshore or onshore in the banking system? Now, if it's onshore in the banking system, it has to be backed with foreign reserves. Otherwise, the government accessing it will require the central bank issuing debt to mop up the liquidity, so it's not really a plus. So you need government deposits backed by foreign reserves, or else government deposits, government assets abroad. And who meets these criteria? You wouldn't be too surprised, I think, at any of the names here. It's in the CFA area, it's the Republic of Congo and Equatorial Guinea that have large financial assets, either deposits at the central bank, the regional central bank, or also direct deposits held abroad. Among other countries that have pegged exchanges in Africa, Lesotho's example. Lesotho is not resource rich, but actually it's rich in the sense that it is a part of the South African Customs Union and gets very, very large transfers from the South Africa much of the time, unless the South African economy is in deep recession. And lastly, you look at those countries with flexible exchange rates. Angola, not surprisingly, built up fairly sizable deposits again after the 2009 shock. Botswana's noted for the pool of fund, which at the onset of the global crisis had 29 months of worth of imports and foreign reserves. And Nigeria, with its excess crude account, really rode through the 2009-10 crisis very nicely and again has rebuilt to a large extent, not totally, the amount of foreign reserves it has. That said, you can have a lot of foreign assets, but if you're a one country, if you're a one product play, as Nigeria is, for example, in the sense of the importance of oil, then you actually need a very large buffer to handle highly volatile oil revenues. So, to sum up, who's got fiscal space? Debt isn't the problem for most countries, but shallow financial markets are for smaller countries, for most poor countries. Pushed to the wall in a downturn, these are the countries that will turn to external financing. Ideally, bilateral and official, but bilateral financing is likely to be a little bit scarcer given fiscal problems in the advanced countries. I've mentioned the case of countries with deep financial markets who were and still remain able to borrow more domestically in a downturn, although as I introduced the South Africa, Ghana caveat. And then there's the natural resource exporters who have accumulated significant reserves. May need to accumulate more, but already have accumulated. So that's story one. Maybe a little policy-oriented, very much, maybe wonkish in nature. But let me go to topic two, which is, I think, less wonkish in nature, and that's the issue of sovereign bond issuance. There's actually a broader thing going on in the region since financial markets kind of stabilized by the end of 2010. There's two kinds of flows. There's the direct issuance of sovereign bonds by many African sovereigns. I'll turn to that in a moment. But also in a significant number of the frontier markets, there's large amounts of inflows directly into domestic markets, into government bond markets in Ghana, for example. Maybe a third of Ghana's domestic bonds are now held by foreigners. Ditto in Nigeria. Also in the case of Nigeria, into the equity markets as well. So there's two distinct phenomena. You know, buying dollar bonds issued on the global markets and then at the same time investing in local markets. I'm going to focus on the first of these, but the second one is also an important phenomenon that we will certainly be looking at more closely. At the moment, 12, I may actually have gone up to 13 at this point following Rwanda's issue, 13 African countries, sub-Saharan, have sovereign bonds that are outstanding. Three or four of these are actually Brady bonds or restructuring bonds, so they're not so interesting. The ones that are interesting are on this table, and they're the countries that in some sense have gone to obtain new money from the markets. Ghana began the process in 2007. As you'll see on the table, since about 2011, there's been a significant number of issues. Nigeria, Zambia, the Zambia one being a real game changer. Tanzania and Rwanda are cited here. Angola did a very strange bond issue as well by borrowing money from a Russian bank that then sort of sold paper backed by the Angolan loan, rather, I'll come back to that point in a moment. It was not the best way to do it in some ways. So what's driving all this? These are the countries that have done bond issues, but Kenya is certainly going to turn to the bond market soon. Unsurprisingly, they were kind of waiting for the end of the elections before jumping into the water. Cameroon is another example, and Angola will probably do a conventional bond issue this year too. So there's a steady flow of potential new borrowers coming to the market. What are the drivers? This slide is not rocket science. The real push factor, of course, is the low interest rates in the advanced economies, the sustained low interest rates, which is pushing a wall of money into emerging markets and into frontier markets as well. The pull factors, I think, in some sense, have already been covered by Antoinette's presentation, which is that for most of the SSA countries have modest levels of both public and external debt. If you're thinking of investing in the European periphery, African numbers look really, really good. Debt levels are very, very low post-debt leaf and post-high growth. And secondly, many of the economies I've mentioned have strong growth stories and acceptable levels of political risk. Countries where you say, yeah, the policy is reasonably predictable over a reasonable period of time, and this growth story is quite strong. They're the pull factors. The result of this is, we've already seen, is the steady flow of newcomers to the market. But also, and this is an important point, moderate spreads. Ghana issued, Zambia, its bond issue in September, spread, the interest rate was about 5.6%, which dollar bond, which is, if even 4 or 5 years ago, would have seemed inconceivable. Indeed, when you look at the issuances by sub-Saharan African issuers and compare them with similar countries with similar credit ratings, there's no sub-Saharan Africa premium. Being in Africa is not a negative. In fact, it seems to be a mild plus for your given credit rating. So on the whole, in some sense, the idea that you're in sub-Saharan Africa, the risky continent, et cetera, that one is gone. I tell a story here because it really captures the point very, very nicely. Back in last summer, June, July, when the Spaniards and the Italians were under severe pressure in the markets, the Spanish finance minister was being harassed by journalists, and being rather arrogant, he sort of dismissed them all, and he said, excuse me, he said, Spain is not Uganda, and he sort of left it at that. And this story is true. 2 days later, the Ugandan finance minister made a presentation on the finances of Uganda. He ended up by saying, remember, he said, Uganda is not Spain. The humor came 2 months later after the Zambia issue, when the FT had a very nice little piece saying, Spain is not Uganda, it's Zambia. Because when the Zambians issued the bond, they issued it at the same interest rates as Spain. And so I wanted to get to the idea that the rate certainly for maybe comparing them with distressed European sovereigns is not the best comparison, but certainly spreads are no different than what they are in Eastern Europe, for example. So it's a very different pricing environment out there. What are the pluses and minuses of all this? I'm going to touch upon them quickly to avoid taking up too much time. Clearly, this is a new source of long-term external financing. It expands the range of choice that African governments have to borrow in the same way that the arrival of China Exim and CDB also expanded the range of choices open to African governments to borrow. And you know, economists, rational choice, et cetera, expanded choice has to be a good thing. I want to mention this, the second point here is some countries are using it to restructure debts, lower costs. A third point mentioned here is that, and this was certainly the case for Nigeria, that the purpose of the bond, the Nigerians have very large foreign reserves, so you don't really need extra money to borrow externally to finance domestic activity. They did it to provide, in some sense, a benchmark issue in the international markets that could then be provided as sort of a benchmark rate for corporates and banks in Nigeria to borrow abroad. And the last one is once you get into the issue of issuing sovereign bonds, there's a big plus is you're almost required by the market to become more transparent, issue more information, handle investors more with more flow of information to increase their comfort level. There's a theoretical argument that it improves macroeconomic discipline. The bond market sort of imposed discipline on the borrowers. If you think about the European periphery over the last 10 or 12 years, you realize that argument's pretty dumb. But it's in the textbooks. The risks, I think actually Steve pointed to some of the risks. Clearly, instead of using investments for productive investment, if you do white elephants, if you use it to finance consumption, then indeed you're creating, beginning to gradually recreate a debt problem for yourself because the growth premium, the growth payoff from the borrowing isn't there. The vulnerabilities, you're now borrowing in foreign currency, you may end up with bunching of repayments, there's rollover risks, etc. These are the kind of factors that governments need to take into account. They're all spelled out on the report in the chapter, so I'm not going to go into them further. So, last comment, how should sub-Saharan Africa sovereign issuers proceed? We've looked across the issuance to date, and some few points made here. One is you've got to think of sovereign bond issuance as just one way of raising funds. There's other debt instruments, borrowing domestically. As I said, there's project finance, there's the multilateral development institutions, et cetera, et cetera. You have to consider this as one piece of a general bond strategy. Clearly, you need to build debt management capacity and acquire TA appropriate assistance. And then you do it probably, how do you do the issue itself? You sort of play it by the rules. You select the legal and financial advisors, you get a sovereign rating. Typically, you make the loan uncomplicated, plain vanilla. Many of the loans have been 10-year bullet payments, loans issued in dollars. And then often there's an argument for a minimum scale of about $500 million. The minimum scale of the 500 million gets you into the global bond indices and therefore makes the bond much more attractive to institutional investors. But if you're a really small country, borrowing $500 million may well be a really dumb thing to do because it's a huge amount of money that you will not be able to use. For example, recently, the recent Rwandan bond issue was only 400 million because Rwandan said, we don't need that much, we need less, and we're going to repay a pile of debt with it. And they got a very attractive outturn on that based on the story behind issuing a smaller amount was quite good. Some of the recent issuance haven't followed these practices. The Tanzania issuance earlier this year was a private placement. It was done without a sovereign rating and has a more complicated structure. As I mentioned earlier, the Angolan issuance last year, indirectly through a Russian bank, also didn't follow these practices. And why was that a bad thing? Well, it was a bad thing because you could see within days that the interest rate the Angolans were paying was very different, significantly higher than the yield on the Russian bank paper that was backed by it. So the Angolans, in some sense, were paying a sizable premium to go the indirect route rather than plain vanilla. So let me leave that at that one and turn to topic number three, story number three. We took on this issue. We did a lot of research on it across the IMF, but particularly in the African Department, because it is a cross-cutting issue, energy subsidy and energy, expanding energy capacity. It cuts across the region, although it's mainly a problem, primarily more a problem in Central and West Africa than in East Africa and Southern Africa, where there's typically a more market-based approach to pricing. Although that's been a hard one, it's taken 10 or 15 years in East Africa to move towards a sort of a full cost recovery of prices. What's the issue on energy subsidies? What's wrong with them? They are, as I mentioned, very widespread, particularly in West Central Africa. Firstly, they're costly to the budget. And by the way, energy subsidies, two of them. The easy one to understand is fuel subsidies, because that's just the you're selling fuel at a cheap price, you're subsidizing it from the budget or from lower tax revenues. It's just a waste of fiscal, it's a use of fiscal resources. But electricity subsidies are more important. Why? Because electricity subsidies can really mess up, and electricity pricing can really mess up incentives to invest in generation. And if you don't think that's a problem, look at this next chart, which I think is truly striking. The bottom line in red on the left-hand side is output per kilowatt hour of electricity in Africa, and it's basically flat over the last 15 years. And I think one thing we can say with confidence is maybe you can get 15 years of growth without energy, without significant growth in energy production. But my God, you're not going to get another 15. It's absolutely central, I think, that the issue of energy production and energy generation be addressed. And as I said, part of that is the issue of addressing subsidies and get, quote unquote, if I could use an old Washington consensus term, getting the prices right. The other angle there, as you can see, is the issue of access to electricity in Africa, which is much, much lower. As you can see, it's very, very low, even compared to South Asia, which is also sluggish in terms of energy. So what do we think is problematic with the energy subsidies? They're expensive. The numbers are there. They're very poorly targeted. This is the Nigerian fuel subsidies, the classic example here. The bottom 40% of the households receive only a small fraction of the fuel subsidy. The upper bound receive very large share of the subsidy. And in this example, to transfer $1 of benefit to the bottom 40%, it costs the government $5. Highly inefficient way of providing subsidies to the poor. Secondly, electricity subsidies are even more regressive, if you like, because the vast majority of the poor don't have access to the grid in the first place. So the beneficiaries, aside from industry, are the higher, better-off households. So what's wrong with all this? As I said, the subsidies reinforce inequality, but secondly, and I think much more importantly, in the case of electricity, they depress growth by really reducing incentives to invest in the energy sector. And then there's the whole issue of crowding up public spending from the budget because you're using it all for fuel subsidies, very much an issue in Nigeria. And then there's other complications regarding the providing excessive incentives to energy-intensive industries to develop. You may think that's what on earth is he talking about here? But if you think of something like the way in which Cahora Bassa is used in Mozambique to basically push energy into the Mos aluminum plant, which employs about 2,000 people. It's a very inefficient use of, and at very attractive prices. It's a very costly way of using electricity in a country where electricity is very scarce. So what did we do? We looked across the countries that have succeeded in the region, and to some extent outside the region as well, to say, well, how do you go about doing energy reform? The first lesson is the issue of you need a comprehensive reform plan. It's not a step, but it's not a piecemeal, let's just jump in and do it. The Nigerian fuel price reform of January 2012 was actually part of a more comprehensive plan to put in place social protection programs and a number of other measures alongside the price increase / subsidy removal. But that's not how it actually played out in reality. Suddenly the price increase from 60 to 160 naira was announced overnight, and all hell broke. I was trying to use a metaphor involved with something hitting the fan, but I'm actually very grateful to Jennifer for bailing me out there. So one is a comprehensive reform plan. A second is a really clear communication strategy. Again, I'll pick Nigeria. If you've all the international coverage or media coverage of the subsidy problem in Nigeria and the crisis it created is, Nigerians just didn't believe the money was going to be used to benefit for them in any way. The only thing they were getting back from the state was cheap oil, cheap travel, and they couldn't be convinced otherwise. And if they look back at 40 years of Nigerian history, you could not argue that they were really missing the picture. But you need a communication strategy and you need a package of measures. You need to explain it really well. Take time. This was a lesson of the reforms in East Africa, in Kenya and Uganda. The reform took an extended period of time and a fairly elaborate public education system, education process. So you get the idea of appropriate phasing and sequencing of price increases. Gradual price increases is typically better than very, very big bang, as perhaps the Nigerian example flags. Three other lessons that we picked up on was, one is the importance of trying to strengthen the, typically in most countries, the generation is going to be done by the state-owned enterprise, or certainly the transmission distribution is. And one really needs to improve efficiency in the state-owned enterprises. You really have to see these as electricity is central to the growth process. You can't really mess around with patronage systems, et cetera, and inefficiencies in the state-owned enterprises delivering electricity, or your growth process will be severely impaired. Lesson five is certainly, I've mentioned already, is one of targeted measures to protect the poor. Cash transfers, if feasible, but if you don't have cash transfers in position, there are other mechanisms that can be developed. And indeed, in the Nigerian case, the finance ministry had developed a series of measures which were to be financed by mother and childcare initiatives, et cetera, et cetera. They were to be financed by the savings from the fuel subsidy, but that got somewhat derailed. The last lesson is the issue of trying to depoliticize price setting, which of course is easier said than done. Typically, you're going to end up a situation where prices, you've got the in electricity, perhaps in fuel as well, you often have near natural monopolies or relatively few suppliers, so you'll typically end up with pricing formulas. It's absolutely imperative these be set outside the political process. Once they become politicized, you go right back into the game of providing subsidies. So these are the lessons we've learned. These are probably the pieces of a reform package. This is not to say in any way that it's an easy thing to do. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you all three for really thoughtful and thought-provoking presentations. We're going to open up for questions. We have about half an hour for that. I want to maybe start with the governance question. And you know, these are, as you said, these are hard, complex issues to take on. You need kind of long-term vision and commitment on something like reforming the energy sector, on getting the fiscal balance right. There are political trade-offs. You have political pushback on creating fiscal space.
I mean, you look at the public worker strikes and so forth. I mean, these aren't easy questions, but I wonder if all of you might say, you know, who you've said a bit who's getting it right, but what accounts for, what is common to those countries that are getting it right? What is it that impels the leadership to make those tough decisions? Is there a common factor in that? Are there public constituencies? Is it just a matter of kind of a couple of champions within government that are moving it? In some cases, some of the more democratic countries may have a harder time pushing through some of those kinds of reforms. So I wonder if maybe you want to reflect a little bit on what is it that impels governments to take these big challenges on. But as you ponder that, then that may be a little difficult to answer. Why don't we take a couple questions, and we'll take a couple rounds of questions and come back to the panel. We'll start with Tony Carroll, a senior associate of CSIS.
Hi. That's right. I'll take it. No discussion whatsoever about subnational debt. Is there an opportunity for subnational debt? I look across this country and I see special districts that have been, you know, funding power plants, schools, dormitories, water treatment plants. And what's particularly remarkable in a recent trip to Nigeria is to what extent the development of a state like Lagos in its public infrastructure in the last 5 or 7 years is just absolutely astounding. And it would seem to me that there'd be an avid audience of takers for bonds that could be used in a state like Nigeria that was backed by the state. Is it all tied up in taxation? What are the impediments to some of those districts in subnational level that could, in effect, use debt more intelligently and more responsibly than what's done at the national level?
Thanks, Jennifer, and thanks to the speakers. I'm Ed Barber from Good Works International, and this actually is a nice coincidence because Tony wants to talk about subnational. I want to talk about supranational. I think all Africans and most of us believe that regional cooperation is going to be necessary, and in some contexts it's essential. Cross-border financing, power pools, transportation projects, et cetera, et cetera. Yet you all haven't said much about that, except for Steve. Frankly, I have believed that a lot of the regional groupings have too long an agenda and too many members to be very effective, SADC and ECOWAS in particular. Some of the others seemed more promising, at least before the Cote d'Ivoire coup. But even there, thinly staffed governments don't have a lot of resources to contribute to regional institutions. So I wondered if you could give us any comments about the prospects. Have there been any positive effects yet of the various regional communities? Thanks very much.
Thank you very much. My name is Tarek Ben Youssef. I'm a senior political officer at the African Union Mission in Washington, D.C. Allow me first to thank very much CSIS and the IMF for organizing this event, which coincides with the African Union celebration of its 50th anniversary. Thank you for giving us this visibility. My question is regarding the diaspora bonds. We are speaking more and more about the potential of the diaspora financing long-term infrastructure projects, development in Africa. And there is an untapped potential about the diaspora contribution to that. What is your assessment of the potential of the diaspora bonds, and what are the best lessons learned from other experience that could be applied to Africa? And if there are practical modalities for developing countries in Africa to learn from best practices, for instance, in India or other countries. Thank you very much.
Maybe start with your question and saying a little bit about what accounts for some countries getting things right in the way of reforms, both energy sector reform, but more generally in the macro more generally on the macro side. You know, I think it's difficult to give a broad sweeping response that, one or two factors have led to successful reforms. I think where the starting point in individual countries is extremely important in terms of, where they are, how long they've gotten to where they are, and how much people are looking to a better day because they've seen so much deterioration or disaster in their recent past. And I think you look to countries, fragile countries, for example, emerging from conflicts like Liberia and other countries there that have seen the results of many years of bad governance and war and all of that, and have an opportunity to come into a period of better leadership, but also not only better leadership, a lot of expectations in the way of a better day for people. And the combination of that sometimes, I think, is a very powerful and ingredients to pushing reforms because leadership is strong and wants to make a difference, and people are certainly are sick of what they've seen in the past and want to see results. So I think leadership is extremely important in reform efforts, and leadership from the top, of course, but pressure from the bottom and accountability from the bottom is extremely important. I think countries obviously can't push forward on reforms comprehensively without a minimum of capacity also. And sometimes there's a need to, when countries don't have that capacity, there are times when it can be facilitated by outsiders or by technical assistance, but capacity is a hugely important ingredient. Capacity that actually works to create institutional capacity, not just substitute TA, but also that really helps countries to do it themselves at some point down the road. And there are times when countries actually faced with complete absence of financing anymore, no donors there to hold the bag anymore, no way to borrow, certainly have to then ask themselves how to finance basic services, and will then start the process of looking at what is less of priority. And I think circumstances can really also be an important motivating factor for reform. So I think it's hard to just have one general picture. I think many African countries on the macro side, of course, had themselves managed very badly for a long period of time and came into the reform effort because many of them had reached the point of desperation, frankly, and had to come to the fund and others for financing, and then proceeded with their reform efforts, being desperate. So I would stop there on that question and maybe say just a little bit about subnational debt. I think in Nigeria, I think Sean probably knows more about Nigeria. He's followed Nigeria a bit closer than I have. But presumably, the nature of many subnational governments in Nigeria, not with the level of credibility that has been growing for Lagos, possibly, and certainly not the first place that people would think of extending debt to because of issues of governance, of lack of capacity, the need for the federal government to actually guarantee those borrowings, all of that, I think, is not the most attractive place that people look to provide financing. So I think elements of capacity and credibility of those governments and taking on difficult reform efforts at their level will be critical for their ability to borrow. On the regional cooperation side, it is the case there are large number of regional organizations in sub-Saharan Africa, and there's a multiplicity. Sometimes many countries belong to several groupings with conflicting obligations that they have and conflicting responsibilities. And there's certainly a need to look at streamlining some of the regional groupings, and that's, I think, an effort that SADC and others have been looking at to see how they can better coordinate and streamline the regional obligations. There are some, I would say, some progress that we're seeing in how certain regional organizations are trying to proceed. We've been working quite a bit with the East African community, for example, in their objectives of ultimately getting to monetary union and all the work they need to do at the fiscal level to be able to think about monetary integration down the road. And I certainly in the dialogue and the discussions and on working on a work program towards ultimately having monetary union, I think some progress in terms of what the challenges are and how to go about addressing them is being made slowly. We do, of course, a lot of work in our surveillance of economic policies of the two monetary unions, the West African Economic and Monetary Union and the Central African Economic and Monetary Union, the CFA zone, in other words, and certainly on the monetary and fiscal side, a lot being done with some degree of progress there. Less of a success among those countries, despite the existence of monetary union in those countries. Very little in the way of progress on trade, you know, on regional trade among those countries, and because of all the other things that they have not dealt with, you know, non-trade barriers between countries, all kinds of customs problems getting across countries, and all of that. So still work in progress across sub-Saharan Africa on the regional integration issue, but a vision of regional integration being essential to making progress on infrastructure, in particular, a lot of interest in doing more on the infrastructure side. And I think institutions like the World Bank and others have certainly been trying to support that. Maybe you'll talk to Diaspora Bones in Nigeria or anything.
Sure. On the sub-national debt question, as I think Antoinette mentioned, I mean, Lagos province is very well run. This is not true of the other 35 provinces. Many, that is to say that there's varying levels of quality of governance across the country. And one lesson I think that we see is absolutely imperative is that on any official government bond issue or any official issuance of a government guarantee, it's absolutely imperative that it be signed off by the Ministry of Finance. Otherwise, literally, you will soon quickly lose control of the debt situation and you're heading right back into an external debt problem very quickly. So I think that issue of central control is really key rather than maybe that would be the thing I would focus on most. It's interesting, actually, that the multilateral development banks, for example, such as the World Bank and I think the AFDB, are interested in engaging within Nigeria, as also is the same in India, with provinces or states that are actually dynamic and are using funds well. I had one thought on the supranational issues of where things are working well or don't work well. You mentioned the power pools, electricity, which is what I'm going to echo from off my own presentation, where I think the Southern African power pool is the only one that works relatively well. The power pools are actually imperative for Africa to obtain cheap electricity. One of the striking features that didn't mention in the subsidies is electricity in Africa is frequently highly subsidized. Even if it's highly subsidized, it's usually very expensive. Yeah. And the dilemma or the contradiction there is summarized in one word, which is scale. You need very large scale generation capacity to be able to deliver electricity at low price. If you're a country like Liberia or Sierra Leone, are there many other, in Niger, we'll say 20, 25 million, you don't have the scale. And so the power pool arrangement, the ability to share around, is absolutely imperative. I'm not sure that's a point that's fully internalized on the continent yet. And on the diaspora bonds, it's an excellent question. And I don't have an answer. We should indeed look at the lessons learned from experience. You mentioned India as an example. Turkey certainly had an elaborate system via Dresdner Bank of raising deposits from Turks living in Germany. Certainly at one point it was $10, $12 billion in terms of its sum. I think you need to look carefully as to whether or not there really is a separate niche there. If in many cases the diaspora may say, well, actually, it'd be more sensible for me to invest my money in what I think is going to generate the highest yield and then send home more money to mom rather than to invest in national bonds that are the diaspora bonds. So you really have to, there's, I think it's going to be specific to very to specific country and cultural situations, but certainly a question I think that we would need to look at actually, looking forward.
Couple of comments. As it relates to governance, I very much agree with Dr. Sayeh. I think governance, it comes from both the bottom and the top. Leadership matters, and participation of local capital is fundamental. And if all the capital comes from outside the market, you don't have the impetus for governance that I think you need to have. In addition, transparency matters. Information, a free press. Sometimes there's a balance between anarchy and a free press, and you've got to address that. But but openness is really important. I think it's terrific that the three next questions all had to do with bonds of different sorts, so I'm thrilled. We may not have the questions answered, but you know what? We're beginning to explore the different questions. As it relates to the subnational bonds, we focused more on Nigeria, but look at Kenya's new constitution, which is, has been created very much for that purpose. Again, I'll go back to Kenya on a supranational bond. The President Kenyatta in Cape Town said it is time to stop harassing our traders and calling them smugglers and opening our borders. It was a small point, but it's a really important point. All of the borders across Africa are populated by tens of thousands of small people trading little commodities and being victimized because they're doing it. That has to stop. These people are the core of the economy. Yes, there are some things that are being traded that there shouldn't be traded, but the majority of them are basic commodities. Omar Issa at the Investment Climate Facility said that they did a study in Tanzania recently of goods being shipped from the port of Dar es Salaam to Rwanda. And it wasn't an issue of the borders. It was an issue in Tanzania of 65 different checkpoints before they even made it to the border. It's time. There's got to be a core level of cooperation across the continent internally in order to scale up regionally. And I think the point of the diaspora bond, India is extremely different from Africa. We got a lot of different countries. We've got a lot of different mothers and a lot of different grandmothers. And we've also got a lot of different countries, and people don't know. Actually, that's not true. My generation doesn't know their neighbors. The next the 20 and 30 somethings do. And I think that it's a process that is going to be worked out. The African citizen is a this generation phenomenon, which my generation kind of fought against for a long time. Opening those borders, creating the African citizen is fundamental to the success of Africa.
Very good. Thanks so much. Great panel. Philippe DePonte, I'm the Africa Director at Eurasia Group. And I just wanted to say, you know, it seems to me, at least in the US, foreign direct investors, I think, still overestimate risk in Africa, but I do wonder whether portfolio investors aren't underestimating some of the risks. Even when you look at sort of the reform-oriented countries, many of which are issuing bonds, you know, one thing that jumps out for those that aren't oil producers is twin deficits. And twin deficits, impervious to 6, 7, 8% growth and for a decade, which I find sort of puzzling. So it seems to be very sticky. So I guess the question would be, kind of how problematic is that from your vantage point? And do you see countries that really have a credible pathway to to addressing one or both of those deficits over the medium term? Thanks.
This will be very quick for Professor Cashin. I know, Steve. Could you briefly address the what I would call barriers and Uber risk managers on the US and European side of actually trying to wire capital into Africa, particularly African countries with an Islamic overlay? In my experience, they don't want to do it. U.S. banks don't want to do it, and you become exhausted, and they won't tell you why.
Yes, and in the far back.
Yes, thank you. Rob Colorina, AIAC Investments. I was at that the event that Steve referred to on the accounting firm with the map on Africa. Antoinette was there. Since then, we've invested in Southern Africa and in MENA, and that's worked out well. To Sean's presentation, I thought it was fantastic. My question is, who's buying these, what's the distribution of the purchasing geographically? Generally, are you seeing any unique trends? And then more of an equity question for Steve, as far as protection for the equity investor, are you seeing some new trends as to the courts and to, I see in South Africa, this Companies Act, that there is actually some respect for areas north of senior debt.
Yeah, thank you again for the panel. It's a great discussion. I was a former economist at the World Bank, and we kind of talked a lot about the real value of the bank was we were a global institution, much like the IMF. And I'm trying to understand how much of, you know, Africa is not, it's a very diverse place. It's not really one place is unique across, which I think is important. But how much are we learning from other places? And I ask that because of a couple questions that I have. One, you know, there was the first discussion what there was a promise for the better day. But are we learning from things what happened in Zimbabwe, what's happening in Mali, what's happening in South Africa? In Kenya, you know, are they going forward or backwards? Secondly, on the borders and energy, are we learning from things like India, Pakistan, in that region, in their borders and their electrical problems there as well of huge subsidies? There's just a good talk twice at the Atlantic Council. They had some people come in. It was very interesting talking. And thirdly, what's very interesting, I haven't heard any discussion on China and its influence. There's a little bit of talk about Russia, but nothing on China.
Maybe to start with the last question, a set of questions, actually, on how much are we learning from other parts of the world in the work on sub-Saharan Africa, and how much are sub-Saharan Africans learning from the rest of the world? I'd say quite a bit. I mean, certainly a resounding request and a constant one we get from our member countries is to bring to them experiences from other countries. And I mean, that's the value added, of course, of international institutions like ourselves, is that we work across the world, and we can bring to them, you know, the experiences of other countries. And we certainly try to do that, especially in the context of the work we do on our regular surveillance work with our countries and the analytic work underpinning those reports, often bring to bear other country experiences. And certainly the work we do in the context of the WIO is driven by cross-country experience. Many African countries are taking it upon themselves constantly to go to other countries to learn about specific issues they're working on. And as you mentioned China, many of them are quite interested and have sought to learn about how China has tackled a number of problems, infrastructure, certainly poverty. The progress made in reducing poverty in China has been a big area of interest for a sub-Saharan African countries. So, I mean, and our work in the fund, of course, with collaboration between various departments, functional departments and the area departments, speak a lot to cross-country work. Our strategy and policy review department, which is the one that does the review function in the fund, is populated by people with cross-country experience, and that's their job, to bring to reviewing and signing off on things the cross-country knowledge of the fund. And so I think there's a lot of that going on, and certainly we can continue to do more, and countries are asking us to bring them together to share lessons among themselves. And one of the things we did in this past spring meetings, for example, with our smaller middle-income countries, which have traditionally felt that they don't get as much attention as our program countries in the fund, we brought them together with people from other parts of the world to talk about some of the challenges of being a small middle-income country, and to talk through those. So certainly something we put some effort into. China, again, just to speak to China, we've actually done quite a bit of work looking at China's relationship with sub-Saharan Africa. Our regional economic outlook from a year and a half ago, I guess, did some work on looking at the trade relationships, sub-Saharan Africa's trade relationships, which have been diversified to the extent that China now, as a single country, is the largest place of African exports. And one of the reasons that sub-Saharan Africa was able to be resilient through this past global crisis was because the trade patterns had changed significantly. Trading more with China and India and the BRICS more generally, trading more internally as well. China, we continue to do quite a bit of work with and collaboration with China, trying to understand and work with them with a view to giving countries the opportunity, of course, to benefit from the additional financing that can be provided and is being provided by China. Some of it non-concessional, so of course has to be managed properly, and there are limits to how much non-concessional borrowing sub-Saharan African countries, low-income countries, can take on and what they're spending those borrowings on. So we've done a lot of work on China, actually. We didn't focus on it in this discussion, but there is quite a bit there. Let me hand over to...
Let me take the question about, in a sense, what's the investor base for the portfolio flows into the frontier markets in sub-Saharan Africa. I'm leaving South Africa entirely to one side. I think, actually, first, it's important to distinguish between the portfolio investors who are buying sovereign bonds, dollar-denominated sovereign bonds, where when you talk to people in London, there's basically a wall of money, is the term being used, going into emerging markets and onto frontier markets in search for yield. And it's a very rich... I was struck at the extent to which people would say the knowledge base of the investors was off on Africa was actually quite thin. It was more a sense of really short term, the yield is really good. I was really dismayed when somebody says, you know, this is a 10-year bond, so the default risk for the next 9 years is zero, so I'm not worried about it at all. I didn't feel that was quite sort of the appropriate level of due diligence. You know, but I think for the dollar bonds, it's a very rich investor base. For inflows, we'll say, for somebody who's investing in Naira bonds or SETI bonds, for example, their country, the type of investment is interesting. It's very much hot money. It's very much a play on real interest, on nominal interest rates versus the potential stability of the exchange rate. You know, the 12% yield in Naira, world oil price looks good, Naira looks good, boom, very high yield. And there you really need to know a little bit more about what you're doing. And so there you have some of the banks, Barclays and others are involved and perhaps on behalf of clients. There's also, I think, a number of boutique firms out there now who focus efforts on investing in Africa. But they would underscore, the difficulties. For most of the bigger funds, many African markets are not worth the effort of investing time in and developing sort of analytical capacity, because the size of markets is still too small to move in and out of, and therefore they don't make the list. That's why I mentioned Nigeria as an excellent example where the market is indeed very thick. So I hope that answers your question. I'd wonder the thought on regional economic cooperation. And I agree with Steve entirely on the issue of the importance of breaking down barriers. But one has to be pragmatic as to what's really going to happen. And I'll give you three examples. ECOWAS is indeed pursuing a sort of a free trade area over time. At the end of the day, the Nigerians, which were, of course, the dominant player, are quite protectionist in orientation and wanted to develop their own industry, whereas the smaller countries in ECOWAS are not interested in buying from Nigeria instead of buying from China. So the issue of moving towards a free trade agreement there is actually, and a customs union, very, very, very different interests among the two countries, among the big guy and the smaller guys. Exactly the same in SADC. South Africa is quite protectionist in its approach, has very tight rules of origin, for example, on inflows of goods that are at free trade within SADC. And so the conflict between the interests of the South Africans and the others is quite deep. It's interesting that the example I think that Antoinette mentioned is East Africa, where there isn't really an economic giant in the region. Kenya's the biggest player. Some of the countries like Tanzania are a little bit touchy about the Kenyans, but it's not in any way something on the scale of the disparity in size between South Africa and Nigeria and their neighbors. That's just a thought.
Do you want to say anything on the first, on the twin deficits, the current account? And
When you asked the question, all I could say was Ghana. That was the question that came to mind, actually, as the one where indeed there are sizable twin deficits. There's a classic political business cycle at work, and perhaps there is a case where investors are underestimating risk or have been. But it's a judgment call. I wouldn't know enough in detail to follow it. I think Ghana is the one case that we see as being where macroeconomic situation is a little bit, where the need for macroeconomic adjustment is quite significant, is probably the fairest thing to say. In other cases, the risks often are the commodities that stand behind the economies. And as I said, oil is an excellent example for Nigeria. And there, the risk is not anything happening in Nigeria, it's the world price of oil. And I think actually investors take those kinds of risks very well into account. That's pretty high on their risk.
So I'll go to Mr. Gibson immediately. I think that the issue of the banking relationships between the U.S. and Africa is totally driven by the by 9/11 and the fright that it's not worth it for American banks to have any relationships across Africa. They literally closed all of the bank accounts, most of the bank accounts for the African embassies here. We who are principal owners of banks across the continent have our correspondent relationships canceled, even though we're American. And in trying to resolve the in trying to engage with the government, it's so many different components of government, even though it may be driven initially by Treasury, because you're hitting so many different levels, no one has taken on this issue, and it hurts. It fundamentally hurts any relationship that the U.S. can ever expect to have as it relates to being a serious investor in Africa, assuming you're going to involve debt. So the oil industry, other large-scale natural resources that doesn't depend on the banking environment to scale up their participation on the continent are kind of outside of that equation. But if you're looking at mid-cap investment, you've got significant issues. But we would like to know why actually you're sending money to Islamic countries. No, so having been born in Libya, that is an issue that comes up on occasion. I'm aware of it. I'm totally aware that it is not funny. It's horrible. It is absolutely horrible. And until we address it, the scale of U.S. participation as investors in Africa will not grow in the way that it should. interestingly enough, so the issue of the Chinese participation in Africa, I would throw that wider. I think, frankly, the Chinese participation in Africa, while there were governance issues and are governance issues, it's woken up a lot of investors coming into the African markets, including the United States. And the level of investment that one sees from Brazil, from Turkey, from any number of other markets that you didn't see 10 years ago has been spectacular. That being said, we do scratch our heads a little bit about that $3 billion bond to Ghana. But on the other hand, we say, so what's the correlation between the debt to Ghana and the Chinese debt in the United States? So I think that it takes two to tango.
We are at time. I want to say thank you so much for really a rich discussion. And I think, you know, we come out of this, for all the risks that stand out there, there is something qualitatively different about this surge right now. The domestic demand that you referred to, I think that builds constituencies for reform, for the difficult reform on energy, on fiscal space, and so forth within those countries. The demonstration effect of countries and states like Lagos that are getting it right, and the political pressure that brings to bear. So I think, as Steve said at the outset, this is not something we would have, you know, this is not the outlook we would have talked about 5-10 years ago. I hope that we can keep you all engaged, because this was just fascinating to me. And I want to thank the audience for joining us, and our panelists, please join me. Thanks.